Welcome to the Ask Your Mentor podcast from Dementia Researcher and Alzheimer's Research UK, where mentees interview their mentors to hear about their careers, experiences, and to find out what makes them tick.
Hello, and welcome to Ask Your Mentor podcast. I'm Dr Josie Fullerton, and I'm a postdoc at the University of Glasgow, and I look at novel treatment for hypertension and stroke using extracellular vesicles. So for anyone who's up to date with the show, you'll know I've already appeared in episode 4 when I was interviewed by my mentee, Alex Meller. But today, it's my turn to shine the spotlight on my awesome mentor, Ian Harrison, which just goes to show that even mentors have mentors. It also shows that mentors don't have to be people with decades of experience. They don't even have to work in the same field. But having someone to talk to who can perhaps help you avoid common mistakes and negative challenges more effectively is invaluable. But that's enough for now. I've kept him waiting long enough. So let's welcome my incredible guest and mentor, Dr. Ian Harrison.
Hello.
Thanks for taking the time to be here, Ian. For those who don't already know Ian, but he's a senior research fellow and principal investigator at University College London, but we'll get to that part. So these shows are about recognising that there's no such thing as a standard career path. So we'll start each one by asking our mentors to take us through their CV. So, Ian, in your best interview style, why don't you take us through your CV?
I started off in science. Well, I should say when I was at school, I was interested in science in kind of secondary school, and then I really liked cooking, and I still really like cooking. So one of the course I was going to do at university was food science, because I thought, well, I like cooking and I like science, so let's just combine the two. Anyway, it was my chemistry teacher at the time who she did pharmacology as her undergrad, and she kind of introduced me to this subject and was telling me a little bit more about it. And so that's where I went, and so started looking into it and started kind of realizing how interesting a subject pharmacology was. So I went to the University of Southampton for my undergrad in pharmacology, and then towards the end of that kind of picked modules that I found interesting at the time, so neuroscience modules, neuropharmacology modules, particularly a module about the neurobiology of neurodegenerative diseases. And so I was like, well, I really like this. How can I kind of study more of this? So started looking into PhDs and applied for a bunch of PhDs when I was in my third year, had a bunch of interviews and didn't get any of them. And so I was like, okay, well, that's not that. Didn't go to plan. So how exactly? So what else? How can I make this work? So I thought, well, I found a couple of labs at Imperial College, which I really liked the kind of science of, and I really liked. I met with one of the PIs there when I was an undergrad at Southampton, because I'm originally from London. My family live in London. So after my undergrad, I moved back home and then moved back. Home to Northwest London, and then started a MRes, a Master of Research in Experimental Neuroscience at Imperial College, and that was really good because it had the way the course was structured is it had three different lab rotations, and you kind of got to spend about 10 to 12 weeks in each rotation, and it's quite good because I didn't really know the labs and I didn't really know the research faces at Imperial, so it kind of introduced me to what was going on there in different areas of kind of neurodegenerative disease which I wanted to work in. Ended up working with Magdalena Sastry, who's still at Imperial, who works in Alzheimer's. I worked with Steve Gentleman, who turned out to be my PhD examiner in the end, and also with David Dexter, who turned out to be my PhD supervisor. So at the end of coming to the end of that MRes year, I was like, right, I'll try again, applying for PhDs. Applied again, got interviews, but this time I got offered a place on an MRC a four-year DTP project at Imperial, which the first year was another master's with a three-year PhD on the end. So this time the master's was in experimental physiology and drug discovery with a bioimaging specialism. So that's when I started using and kind of learned a lot about different biomedical imaging techniques and how they can be used in neuroscience and particularly neurodegeneration research. And then chose to stay in, did my project with Professor David Dexter in Parkinson's disease research, and then stayed with him for the next 3 years to do my PhD. So at the end of that, David and I were writing a grant, an MRC grant, to kind of not continue the work that I was doing, but continue a similar project. So the plan was I was gonna stay there, I was gonna convert to postdoc, but then we found out that we didn't get the money, which sucks a bit. But it's kind of I think it was a good thing in the end. So which meant me applying for jobs, got offered a job as a postdoc at UCL at the Centre of Advanced Biomedical Imaging, or CABI, with Professor Mark Lithgow. So started there as a postdoc, and I was initially recruited on it was a 14-month project. I was kind of taking over from somebody who left, really liked it. It was a really interesting project where I was working with Eli Lilly, the pharmaceutical company, to develop imaging techniques to look at pathology in one of their tau mouse models, and to kind of create a pipeline of imaging biomarkers that we could translate clinically. So it's quite good. I used to have these kind of teleconferences with a team in America who are working on similar things, another group in the UK, and we were kind of coordinating the whole thing. So that funding came to an end, and luckily my boss had some extra funding for me, so I kind of got extended and extended and extended. So I ended up being there for kind of 4-5 years, and that's the time when I started applying for fellowships, really, which leads me to now.
Thank you very much. I've got some questions to go back on, if that's all right.
Yeah.
First of all, are you still as interested in food?
I am. when I was at Imperial, I started a cake club. So on Monday afternoons, we used to all meet up at 3 p.m. and we used to take it in turns to bake. When I arrived at UCL, I was like, "What? Nobody eats cake here. This needs to change." So again, started the Cabby Cake Club at UCL.
That's amazing. Do you bake?
Yeah. So what we do is, like, we take it in turns, and every Monday one person bakes, and then it's very well. It's a lot more competitive at UCL than it was at Imperial. We like secretly rank everyone's cakes, and then all the scores are collated at the end, and then we give out rosettes and stuff at the end of the year, which is quite fun.
That's excellent. Yeah. The only time I have baked was for an ARUK like charity bake sale, and I ended up having to buy my own cake.
Buy your cake back.
Oh, that's brilliant. So going on from your undergraduate, you then went to a master's with rotation. Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering how you found the rotation. Do you think that's quite a positive experience?
It was good, yeah. I guess the only negative thing about it is because it was so short, like you had like 10 or 12 weeks, by the time you were really getting into the research and getting data, you had to write up a report and leave. So that's the thing I found most frustrating about it. I liked kind of getting into it and doing the reading and getting up and running with experiments quickly. But when you're on that bit when everything's working and it's like, right, we finished now, next one, out you go. But it was good, and it's kind of good that it was that short, because it makes you go to different labs and you experience different things and different supervisor styles and what the type of thing that you like working with and how you kind of want your research experience to be like. Because a PhD is a big time, right? It's 3 years that you want to be happy during that time, and you want to be sure that you're working in an environment where you're going to be happy. But
so what, going on from that then, so what did make you want to do a PhD, knowing that it's 3 years of your life studying and working and,
yeah,
you know, we all know the challenges of doing a PhD. So, but yeah. What drove you to do it?
One of the things was because of this kind of short time scale that I was talking about rotations, I was like, I can't imagine a project big enough to keep me busy for 3 years. And I was like, I can't even, back then anyway, now I can, but I couldn't contemplate kind of what I was going to do for 3 years and how I was going to write up this big book for people to read at the end and examine me on. But again, it's one of those things that I wanted to get into it and really start, you know, have one experiment lead to another experiment and kind of follow the science through rather than it being cut short because I was only a rotation student. So I think that's probably one of the main things that attracted me to it. It was just wanting to see how science goes, you know?
Oh no, definitely. It's the unknown.
Yeah.
It's like the fact that you're working on something new, most times, you're working on something new and unknown.
Yeah.
That may or may not work. How did you find your Viva?
It was quite nice, really. That sounds, and I've spoken to people before that have had a horrible time, but I really quite enjoyed it. It's quite, and you realise now, kind of off the back of it, how rare it is that you just sit down and talk about your research, people talking about your research with you for an extended period of time. You know, yeah, exactly. Are forced to listen because they're sat in a room with you. But yeah, I found it really enjoyable, and it was good that you know, we really got into the pros and cons of the data. We looked at, I found it enjoyable, less scary than, I mean, I was terrified going into it, but as soon as I was in there, within about 10 minutes, I was like, all right, this is all it is. We're just talking about my research, and I know this because I've been doing it for the last 3 years. So, yeah.
So then going on from that, so you did your PhD, and then that's when you started applying for grants for things like the MRC. I'm just wondering, how did you find it dealing with rejection? You know, like that's, obviously it's quite a common theme. But that early on is quite, quite a hit to take.
Because I think in my head I was like, well, with the whole applying for PhDs thing, because I didn't get it first go, I was like, I'll just try again next year. So, I kind of had that mentality of like, well, I'll just keep trying until it happens. But with this, because my PhD funding was running out and not getting this grant, I was like, I can't afford to, like, I need a job. I need to pay my rent now. Like, I couldn't, there was no option of just kind of waiting until some money came about. So yeah, it sucks. But I think, having carried on in the academia and research, you kind of find ways to deal with it, I think, and you find it gets easier every time, I think.
And then after you were employed in your first sort of postdoc job, you mentioned that you're on quite short contracts.
Yeah,
that is, you know, a recurring theme.
Yeah.
Through being a postdoc, short contracts and job security. Just wondering, how did you find that? Did it bother you, or was it kind
of and I think at that kind of career state, well, at that age as well, especially, like, you're just kind of establishing yourself. Loads of my friends were buying houses, and I was like, oh well, if I go to a, you know, the bank, exactly, I'll go to a bank just saying like, yeah, I'm going to be employed for 9 more months, but after that I don't know. So, you know, it's crap, and it goes from you go from one contract to the next, and in between each contract, I should mention, there was all of that. There's those times where I was like, okay, well, I can't do this anymore. This is stupid. And then start looking for other jobs and start looking for other things. But yeah, it just kind of, I think from my case, a lot of it has been luck of the draw. Like, it just so happened that there was a grant coming up when mine was finishing. And it's just kind of worked well that's the way things have gone. But yeah, brutal short-term contracts.
So would you change anything in your path up till now? Would that would you like looking back?
It's hard to think that when it, like, everything's gone well so far. It's hard to now think back, and, you know, I think I'd have quite a different career if I was to say, if I stayed at Imperial, for example. I think I'm glad I changed changed universities when I did, I think it's quite a good, it kind of gave me that kind of separation between PhD and postdoc. And the way kind of moving to another lab as a postdoc, people kind of listen to your opinions in a different way to when you're a PhD student. When you're a PhD student, you're very focused on your own project and coming in and kind of being in group meetings and kind of talking about other people's data. You realize that you have so many more skills than you thought you did because you've been in the same place with the same people and the same kind of type of research. It's only when you move around and you're like, oh, actually, yeah, I know how to do all those experiments because I did them as, you know, postgrad or did them as a rotation, you know? It's only moving around that you kind of start to see that, I think.
Did you feel the pressure to ever leave London? I know you changed the institutions. Yeah. Was there an outside pressure to...
A bit. And I remember at the end of my PhD, kind of, I remember a meeting that, having with my boss and saying, you know, but I don't want to leave because I've not gone far. I've gone from West London to North London.
I'm not better. I went from West Glasgow to.
So it's not like I've gone far, but it's, I think in the back of my head, it's always one of the things that you hear about and that you read about, that like you need to move, you need to do a postdoc in the States and then you need to come back. It will completely change the way that you, and I can't really comment on that because I didn't do it, obviously, but kind of worked with other postdocs who, you know, went to the States to do a 3-year postdoc and then come back, and say that it hugely benefited them. But I was just at that kind of life stage and kind of starting to settle down. And I was like, I don't really want to just uproot and move somewhere.
So then going on from your postdocs, you then started applying for fellowships, which, as you know, is quite an interesting topic of mine right now. How did you find that? Did it take a while to come up with sort of your own niche, your own project?
I think I was very lucky in the fact that, I should start off by saying there was, well, when I was, because I obviously I didn't move for when I was a postdoc, so I started as a postdoc when I was in the same lab all the way through for like 4 years, and it's only kind of towards the end of that 4 years and I had a bit of funding left where I wanted to take bits of the project off in different directions where it was clear that my supervisor didn't. And because I had quite a different skill set to my supervisor and the people that I was working with, because I was I'm a neuroscientist, a pharmacologist, working in an imaging lab, and a lot of the work that people do at CABI is kind of designing new imaging protocols and using the MRI scanner or the PET scanner to measure different things in the brain, for example. Whereas I was more interested in, okay, this pathway in the brain, what does that mean for disease? Can I play around with it with drugs? Can I do these other things? So it's kind of a project kind of naturally came to mind when I was thinking, right, actually, I'd really like to do this as a fellowship. I kind of spoke to my boss about it, and he was saying, I was lucky in the fact that I had maybe like 6 months to a year of money left. And he said, well, you've got these papers, you've got these other things to finish off, but focus on your fellowship writing, get it done, and then we'll kind of readdress it in 6 months' time. So that's what I did. I kind of went all in. I remember there was 3 deadlines. There was one on, I think, like the 10th of January, one was the beginning of February, and the other one was the 6th of March, and I applied for all 3 back to back. And I remember, so that Christmas, I just spent the whole time was just locked away working on applications. I learned a lot just from, you know, having to sort out finances and having to get everything approved internally and all the stuff that you need to do in the background of writing the science bit that is going to convince the funder to give you money. So a lot of it was learning of doing one application, be like, okay, that's what went wrong with that one. How do I improve it for the next one? And I say the next one, it was all kind of bam, 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 bam. But yeah, no, stressful.
So you applied for your boom, 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 three fellowships. And then what happened next? Interviews?
Actually, the pre-application for the welcome one that I applied for was in like the November. So then found out in the December that I was invited for the full application. So that was one, the full application, that was the first one in January. And then I applied for the ARUK one and the Parkinson's UK one. The welcome one, found out that I didn't get an interview. Got a bit of feedback, but not much. But the other two, Alzheimer's Research UK and Parkinson's UK, got feedback from decent review scores. So got to rebut some of those. Oh, no, actually, no, I've got that wrong. Got the review scores back, was told that I was invited for interview and that I could kind of rebut any comments that the reviewer said in the interview. So I had the two interviews for those, Parkinson's UK and Alzheimer's Research UK. They were like 2.5 weeks apart. So, and one was completely focused on Alzheimer's disease and this pathway and how tau builds up, and one was completely focused on Parkinson's. There was the pathway, the brain was similar, but the pathologies were very separate, different animal models, different protein. So I kind of put one to bed in my head and I was like, right, I'm just doing this until this interview, and then gave myself a couple of days recovery. And then I was like, right, I'm just doing Parkinson's now for the next month. So, had interviews and they both went really well. So then found out that I got the Parkinson's one shortly after the interview, and then the Alzheimer's one, I got an offer for that as well. So then...
That's incredible.
Yeah, I'm fully aware that it was very fluky to get both. And I think it's a case of applying for all of them all in one go, in the hope that I think I still have that mentality of that failure mentality of, if I just apply for as much as I can, then hopefully one of them will stick and I'll get it.
But that's incredible. The fact that, you know, two funders offered you that. That's amazing.
Yeah.
So how did you decide? What did you do?
I spent ages making like pros and cons lists and talking to different colleagues, talking to kind of collaborators in Parkinson's, collaborators in Alzheimer's, people that kind of had big labs that worked on both. We were having some like family dinner at home, and it was my father-in-law actually was just like, why don't you just take both of them? Can't you just do that? I was like, no, you can't. They're just for one fellow, right? You just can't. And then I was like, well, maybe I can take both. So then I arranged a kind of phone call meetings with the director of research at Alzheimer's Research UK and the kind of similar post at Parkinson's UK, and kind of said that, like, this is a situation I'm in. I've been offered both. Is there a possibility that I can do both? Because I want to do both of these projects. So I put them in touch and they kind of talked it out, and they kind of came back to me and they said, we'd be happy for you to take on both if you split your time between the two projects. And then that meant that the other salary that was included in the projects, I could then recruit a postdoc to kind of sit between the two projects as well. So I didn't have to decide. All my pros and cons lists were kind of a waste of time. So I did that. So I accepted both. And then kind of immediately started advertising for the postdoc to kind of get things running. So it was a bit of a in at the deep end. I started and suddenly has to deal with HR and write a job advert and already had a group effectively.
How did you choose a postdoc? You are a postdoc essentially.
Right.
At that stage, yes. And then you're setting up interview panels to interview a postdoc and hire. How did you decide who to hire?
I don't know, because we've got quite a few applications and I kind of narrowed it down. It was really hard actually thinking about it. And I had the help of a couple of my colleagues, so two fellows that are also in my department, and they kind of helped me with it being on the interview panel. And their kind of guidance and expertise was quite good at this because they'd obviously been there before, they'd hired postdocs. So it's quite nice having them, you'd have the interview one with a candidate and they'd give you a really cool science presentation, and off the back of it, you know, they leave the room and then I'm all excited saying, wow, wasn't that cool? What do you think? And they're like, yeah, have you thought about this? And then you're like, oh, okay. Yeah, and it makes you think about, rather than just getting excited about the science and how engaging they are as a speaker, thinking about, okay, now how are they going to fit into this project? Like, I'd love to hire all of the people that I interview, but I need to find the right person to fit on this project. Because it was quite a weird project that they were split 50-50 between these two fellowships, and it's kind of less of a traditional postdoc where you've got this project to get on with. It was very much like me and this person would be working together the whole time. So I wanted to make sure that I chose well. But yeah, thankfully I did.
But it's also hard because you're going from being a postdoc, as I say, to then essentially being a line manager for somebody for the first time.
Yeah.
You know, it's a huge jump.
Yeah.
So that roughly brings us up to sort of present day. So I've got some questions about what you're doing just now. So first of all, can you tell us a bit about your research and what excites you most about the work you're doing on either of your 50-50 projects? You don't have to decide between the two.
I work on the glymphatic system, which is a pathway in the brain for solute clearance and removal of waste products. So what we're looking at in both Alzheimer's and Parkinson's is to see if this pathway fluid movement is involved in the propagation of proteins throughout the brain. So we're looking at intracellular proteins, so tau in Alzheimer's disease and alpha-synuclein in Parkinson's. And what we're doing is we've established these animal models of prion-like propagation, so a model of tau propagation and a model of synuclein propagation. And we're treating those mice with different drugs to either inhibit the glymphatic system or to speed it up, and then to study them long term with behavior, do histology and imaging at the end to see if our intervention and to see what the effects of altering glymphatic function are. And at the same time, we're kind of doing this natural aging study where we've kind of established the models of tau and synuclein pathology, and we're studying the function of the glymphatic system over time to see if the system inherently becomes impaired, for example, as the mice develops the disease. So they're kind of like the three work packages that each fellowship is composed of. But what was the second part of the question?
What excites you most about them? What do you like about most?
I think this sounds really sad, but I think one of my favorite things is making graphs at the end. so I think because I've seen firsthand now the amount of effort that it takes to import the breeders, for example, establish the colony, get transgenic colony breeding up and running, get everything working, then transport the animals to the experimental, you know, all the licensing involved in that stuff as well, doing the injections, treating the mice, getting the brains at the end, and you know, doing the Westerns, PCRs, whatever, and then getting numbers at the end. I'm like, okay, did this actually work, or have I just been yeah. So I think that's the bit that excites me, of seeing the results at the end and being like, you know what, like I've done that now from start to finish. I can say that those data points are, you know, it kind of means a lot more.
On the back of that then, so obviously you're now a PI. Do you find that your time in your lab is still just as much? Are you still quite hands-on?
Yeah, I'm still quite hands-on. I still kind of do, the way we ended up doing it, me and the postdoc, we kind of split different parts of the project, rather than, you know, one of us taking Alzheimer's, one of us taking Parkinson's. We kind of split things so that we have our own different roles in the way that it's worked. So like I do all the surgeries, for example, Doug does all of the behavior and things like that. So it's meant that I'm constantly in the lab doing stuff, doing analysis and Westerns and PCRs and all the rest of it. But on top of that, there is, yeah, there's a lot of admin and other bits and bobs that you kind of get tasked with when, you know, and even just things that which I didn't really appreciate at the time, because I'd working with Eli Lilly on this when I was a postdoc, when we needed mice, it was a case of you emailed a certain person, they would say, oh yes, I've got these mice at the right age time point, and then they would send them to you and then you could do your experiment. With this, it was kind of, you know, setting up the breeders and planning way in advance, which I'd never done before. And I realized how much more time stuff like that takes, or just, you know, having to go get some ear snips because you need to genotype them and stuff like that. And a lot of, I mean, it's been great being able to do both projects, but both of them come with their own sets of admin, and kind of helping the charities out and stuff as well. So kind of public events for Parkinson's UK as well with Alzheimer's Research UK. So although I'm doing two fellowships, I'm kind of one fellow between two fellowships.
So it's safe to say you're quite busy.
Yeah. Rather be busy than bored.
Well, exactly. So we obviously know that in academia that work-life balance can be a bit challenging. And you do have a lovely family as well. How do you manage day-to-day family life with two fellowships?
Yeah. With difficulty, yeah. In short. Yeah. Yeah. Like you say, so I've got two kids. They have 3 and nearly 5. So one of them has just started primary school, the other one's at nursery. So, it's a lot of juggling things between me and my wife. So my wife works full time as well. So we're very good. I swear by this, that if you want anything logistically organized, ask a working parent to do it, because we can make amazing things logistically happen. You know, certain person needs to be here at a certain time with this PE kit in their bag, whilst that person has to do that. That one's got a meeting in town at that time. Of just, you know, making all 4 of us being in the right place at the right time, with the right clothes on, fed, showered, watered. So it's a bit brutal, but I'm quite strict in terms of my time. So like my colleagues at work know that, you know, I've got school pickups to do at a certain time. So I need to leave. Like I can't attend meetings outside of core hours, for example. So we just don't have our meetings outside of core hours. Things like that, which on certain days I need to leave at 3:30, 4 o'clock, because I need to pick up at a certain time. And even on days when that isn't happening, kind of it's my wife's turn to pick up from school that day, I'm quite strict that at 5 o'clock, that's when I leave. And then I don't think about work until the next time I'm at my desk the next morning, which is important, I think, because especially in science, in academia, it's quite hard to draw that line at the end of the day, because it's easy to just continue your work at home and to carry on reading papers and stuff. But I think I need it mentally to just have that downtime. And I think having that routine of being at work at certain hours during the day makes me way more productive and focused when I'm at work, because, you know, I need to get something done because I need to leave at a certain time and I don't want to, you know, miss pickup, or I want to be home for bath time. You know what I mean? Things like that.
I think that's really refreshing to hear. And I think that's a big, big thing about academia that people end up leaving.
Yeah.
It's because of the work life.
Yeah.
So I think that's really nice to hear.
So I think you can, it's possible. It just takes some work, I think.
In this part of the show, we're going to do some some quick fire career questions. They're going to be short and snappy answers.
Okay.
This one's quite relevant. What is one thing you wish someone had told you when you were at the career stage that I'm at currently?
It will happen. I think that's one thing. When I was working on fellowship applications and stuff, it was one of those things that I was like, oh, I'm never going to get this. This project's rubbish. I can't do this. I can't get this I can't get finances approved. And, you know, like it will happen. You will make it happen. If fellowship applications and stuff, if it doesn't happen on this time, it will next time.
So apart from the graphs, what motivates you to continue learning and making new discoveries?
I think just from it's been great working with the charities, because it's exposed me to, because, you know, I'm a basic kind of preclinical scientist, where we don't mix with patients, we don't see patients. So working with the charities has been great, because it's allowed me to do things like organize patient visit days, and we kind of have like charity donors come in and kind of look around the lab. It's things like that. When you describe your work to somebody who has Parkinson's and they get it, and you see how excited they are about what you're doing, it kind of puts it into perspective. Like, it might seem like, oh yeah, I've been running Western blots for what it seems like months just to get these time points done. But when you kind of describe the data, it really kind of puts into perspective of what that means to that person's life, knowing that they know that somebody is working flat out to try and cure this disease that affects them and their families, you know. So yeah, I think that.
I think that's it. It's when you see the ARUK meetings, yeah, you see the people with lived experience, you know, talking to us, and they have dementia, and they have Alzheimer's disease. It's incredible. It makes you realise that, yes, if you're Western, hasn't worked, it's not the world. And to keep going, it's very important. What do you think male scientists could do to be better advocates to encourage for improved equality?
Gosh, that is a big question. Encourage your colleagues, and, well, treat your, the way I kind of would approach this is, I know how I kind of run things in my lab group, and I know how it doesn't matter, you know, sex, age, you know, anything like that. It doesn't matter when you're a scientist. It's what you're doing. It's the research that you're carrying out, things like that. So that's how I run things from my lab. But in terms of encouraging equality, I think a lot of it is leading by example, showing people that you can, you know, have a lab with people of, you know, sexes, whatever, at various different career stages. We all work together. We all have this common interest in achieving this research goal. But in terms of, you know, encouraging equality, I'd say, like, encourage people to do things, and suggesting people for like, if I'm in invited to meetings, for example, if I can't do it, encourage people, you know, suggest names of people who you think wouldn't ordinarily put their name forward for things, encourage them to go for it, encourage them to take those steps. And things like, I found just locally, you find that people, if applying for a job, for example, people will be like, oh, well, I can't do that because I haven't got all of the skills. Where you constantly read things like that, where men read a job advert and would go for it even if they haven't got all of the skills that are listed, where women are less likely to do that because of fear of not getting it. So it's kind of encouraging that and instilling that in trainees and people that come through your lab to just go for it, just try. Like, the rest of us are trying. All we can do is try, and hopefully something will happen.
I think that we'll end on that one for the career question, because that was a bit of a... So that's the last career question. So my main takeaways from that are, first of all, that you like cake, that we should introduce baked days at the University of Glasgow. But I think one big thing for me is that it will happen. I think that's important probably through all stages of your career, as well as, you know, the stage I'm at now. I think it's really important that you're saying about work-life balance and to be home for bath time or dog walk or, you know, whatever you have at home that's important to you. I think that's essential. And also you just touched on that what you're doing really counts, you know, having, you are making an impact in the wider health and disease knowledge base, and to lead by example and to encourage others. So I think all of those are wonderful little take-home messages that I could write and post it all over. So we're now in the last segment of the show. And before we finish, I just wanted to talk a little bit about mentoring. So why did you decide to become a mentor? And what advice would you give for anyone who's listening that doesn't have
a mentor? Get a mentor. It's the first advice. The reason I decided to do it was I was quite lucky in as a postdoc applying for fellowships, because I was in a lab which had a history of postdocs converting to fellowships, them going and applying for funding and being successful. And so I was surrounded by other fellows and other people that were kind of 5-10 years ahead of me on that same career trajectory that I could kind of look up to, and kind of they mentored me and helped me with applications and interviews and things like that. But realizing it's only kind of when I got my fellowship that when you go to other conferences and you speak to other kind of new PIs and new fellows, and you realize that that really isn't the case for a lot of new group leaders. They're not in that scenario. Different size labs, different size departments, and they don't have that similar kind of network of fellows around them. So I think that's one of the main things of why I wanted to do it, is to, as I said, I've been very fortunate in that I've had that support, but I was kind of aware that a lot of people haven't, as to try and help people along to, you know, to be that virtual fellow that's kind of a colleague that can mentor them through certain things. So
and personally it's been very, very positive and a good advantage to me. Definitely I appreciate that you did become a mentor. So then on the other side of things, if you could choose anyone alive or dead to be your mentor, who would you choose?
I don't want to piss off any of my mentors that I already have. Just choosing somebody else. Okay, I'm going to say this person's alive and they're still an amazing scientist, Mike and Nedegaard, who, so she was the lead PI of the group that discovered the glymphatic system. So that's one thing, because it's a bit of, you know, science kind of envy. But some of the stuff that her and her lab have done have been, she's so pioneering in all of the work that they do, that I'm just kind of in awe of her. She's also got 5 kids and she's a professor in like Rochester and in Copenhagen. She's an amazing woman. And I just don't know how I want to get some of that, of how she does that, and just casually, you know, publishes science papers. And that she's at that career stage now where she's, you know, the top of her game. She kind of runs these 2 research groups, one in America and one in Denmark. And how she is able to do that, have her home life, you know, work-life balance at the same time, and kind of the pioneering experiments that she does. Like, they did stuff that you wouldn't even think of doing. Like, why? Yeah. Like they put human astrocytes in a mouse brain just to see what happens, like, and then from that, like, they know that astrocytes are involved in neuronal signaling. Like, it's just the weird experiments that they do and publish, and then Yeah, I think it should be an in-person.
But an amazing, amazing
yeah, to just see how person. Both science-wise yeah. And kind yeah. of career work-wise would be an amazing person to take advice from, oh, you know?
Definitely. Absolutely. I'm not offended that you didn't choose me. So I think that's a really nice point to end on. So I'd say that's all we have time for today. I'd like to thank my amazing mentor and guest, Dr. Ian Harrison. If you would like to find out more about Ian and his work, you'll find his and my bio on the Dementia Researcher website. The Ask Your Mentor podcast will be back soon with another mentee talking to their mentor. But for now, I'm off to plan my career. You've got a few things to do. But I'm Josie Fullerton, and you've been listening to Ask the Mentor podcast from the Dementia Researcher in association with Alzheimer's Research UK.
Bye.
Bye.